हेलो जया, गुड आफ्टरनून.
गुड आफ्टरनून सर। गुड आफ्टरनून सर।
आफ्टरनून. सो जया, वेयर आर यू टुडे? वेयर आर यू जॉइनिंग अस फ्रॉम?
सर आई एम जॉइनिंग फ्रॉम देवघर इन झारखंड।
झारखंड.
यस सर।
विच प्लेस इन झारखंड यू सेड?
सर देवघर डिस्ट्रिक्ट।
देवघर. सो वेलकम टू दिस मॉक इंटरव्यू.
थैंक यू सर।
व्हेन इज योर इंटरव्यू शेड्यूल्ड फॉर?
So it is on 7th of September.
Good. So you have plenty of time to further improve in case there are any points. Have you taken any mock interviews so far?
Yes, sir. I have taken 2 to 3 mocks more.
Very good, excellent. So you know what it all means. Now tell us a little bit more about yourself, about your background, about your education, about your interests, about your family, and about your career goals. So, could you enlighten us more about yourself?
Sir, my name is Jaya Sneh. I am from Devgarh district of Jharkhand. I have completed my bachelor's in 2019 from Indira Gandhi National Open University, and currently I am pursuing my master's in Jawaharlal Nehru University in politics with specialization in international relations. And sir, this is my second attempt in UPSC and my first interview.
Okay. About your family, anything you'd like to tell us? Your father, your mother, your siblings?
Sir, I have a younger brother and a younger sister. My father is a government servant, and he works in Bihar as a teacher, and my mother is a homemaker.
Okay. Mentioned that you are studying at Jawaharlal Nehru University and in international relations, in political science, and so on. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
So, we have been reading a lot about Jawaharlal Nehru University, what's going on. It remains like a mystery and enigma. Can you tell us about JNN University? What is the state of education there? And is it fine? You are happy with your education, your campus, the atmosphere, and so on?
Sir, it is a really good atmosphere to learn, though I have done my entire first semester in online mode only. So I cannot tell you so much about the campus atmosphere. However, the teachers are really experienced, and it is a once in a lifetime experience to be a part of such a prestigious university.
That's very nice to hear this. But you must have heard from your colleagues about the kind of issues I was alluding to.
Yes, sir.
So, what is it that you have heard about it? Some of the lawlessness, some of the anti-national elements, and so on in that university?
Yes, sir. There have been protests at Jawaharlal Nehru University by student organizations, and this has been more in news in the last 2 to 3 years.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So why so? Why it has suddenly sprung into news? It was such a fine university. It is such a fine university. Why suddenly there has been this sudden upsurge of these kind of news?
Sir, I feel that student activists often forget the larger goals of the nation and the society and further their individual interests. And this has increased in the recent years.
Why so?
Sir, I feel that this is because of the increasing individualism.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Right. So what are your career goals in life? What do you wish to do?
Sir, since childhood, I have always aspired to be a civil servant, and I am dedicatedly preparing for this.
But joining civil service is just a medium of achieving something larger, something bigger. So,
Yes,
what is
sir.
it that you want to achieve?
Sir, I have lived my entire life in a semi-rural background, and I have seen many problems that the people here face. And I want to be in a position where these problems become less issues. And the rural-urban divide in the society, the position of women, more so in the semi-urban areas, these things are better improved.
Suppose you are a district collector in a district, a backward area, let's say in your own district where you are right now in Devgarh. What would you do in order to improve the condition, the status of women in your area?
So first of all, I would involve the local community in the effort, and I would empower the women self-help groups and ensure that women are given access to entrepreneurship and microcredit. And for the young girls, I would ensure that they are given self-defense training, and there are street lights and other facilities for the safety of women. And sir, most importantly, I would ensure that gender sensitization takes place, because the government is making a lot of efforts, but it needs to penetrate down to the level of the society.
For the safety of young women, which are the specific measures which could be taken to make sure that antisocial elements are kept under check at bay, and those young girls, young women could be provided safety?
So we can scan the areas regarding women's safety, that which areas are more prone to the safety issues of women, and we can deploy more police personnel, including women police officers. And also, sir, we can ensure that both girls and boys, right from childhood, are given basic gender sensitization, so that no one sees women as the weaker sex, which they are called. And also, sir, I want to ensure that the women of the area themselves take up the mantle to report the cases of gender-based violence, and that an attitudinal change is there.
What is the gender ratio in your district?
So it is 925 women per 1,000 men.
What can be done to improve the gender ratio?
So first of all, sex selective abortion is still prevalent despite the strict measures that are taken by the government. And also, young girls are even subject to lesser hospitalized. They are even given lesser hospitalization, lesser health care. And these things need to be looked. And we can rope in the Anganwadi workers for this and the Asha workers. Also, sir, we can ensure that the girls and the boys at the school level are given training to ensure that when such incidents occur, they report it at their family level and at the society level.
What is the role of Anganwadi workers? And what is the role of Asha workers? Just illustrate.
So Anganwadi workers are there in the ICDS program, are involved in ICDS program, and they give nutritious meals to both the women, both pregnant and lactating women, and also children from 0 to 6 years of age. And Asha workers are the frontline healthcare workers, and they ensure that women and men and the entire family gets basic health services, and their need has increased more in the recent corona pandemic.
Thank you. Over to you, Neeraj ji.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
So, Jaya, your optional subject was political science and international relations.
Yes.
So, do you follow international relations during present times?
Yes.
What area interests you the most?
Sir, recently, because of the developments in Afghanistan, I have been following that issue.
Okay.
And this is an interest topic to me.
Okay. So, why is the situation that is obtaining in Afghanistan a source of worry for India?
So 30 years ago, when insurgency was there in Afghanistan, then insurgency and terrorism also increased in the Jammu Kashmir region. And sir, this national security angle is the main cause of worry.
So what exactly is happening at present in Afghanistan?
Sir, the US troops have withdrawn, and it is said that the Taliban are gaining more territory under their control.
Who are the Taliban?
Sir, the Taliban have dealt in terrorist and anti-national activities in 1990s and in 2000s. However, right now they are also a part of the power sharing agreement.
No, what does the meaning of Taliban?
Sir, I cannot recall it at this moment.
But why do you call them a terrorist group, or why do you call them anti-national? They are anti-national to whom? Anti-national to Afghanistan or anti-national to India?
Sir, to an angle, it is to Afghanistan as well, because they have engaged in violence and they are still focused on a violent takeover of power, even though they are preaching the contrary.
What is the origin of Taliban? How did Taliban come into existence?
Sir, I have read that Taliban came into existence from the religious schools of Pakistan. There were local Pashtun fighters and students in the region, and they have taken the power in Afghanistan region.
But how did they reach Pakistan?
Sir, I am not very sure about this.
Yes. So as a student of international relations, and also as a person who takes a lot of interest in Afghanistan, we should know about the evolution of Taliban, how they came about, what is the meaning of Taliban, and what are their objectives, why are they forced to reckon with in Afghanistan, and why do they matter in most talks, international talks that are happening relating to Afghanistan. They are being invited,
yes,
as stakeholders. So there must be something more to it. I mean,
yes,
just like Lashkar-e-Taiba or Jaish-e-Mohammed cannot be invited to negotiating table. But Taliban are not in that bracket. They are in a different league. And so one should know about it. Tell me, why is political science a science?
Sir, political science is not a pure science, but it is a social science. And also, sir, it is multidimensional. There are many disciplines, and there is also comparative politics and behavioralist approach in political science. And these aspects involve, to a large extent, scientific approaches like theories and experimentation, observation. So political science is called a science, though, sir, I would say that it is more of a social science.
No, but like in science, you can go to a laboratory and carry out experiments. You see the cause and effect right in front of your eyes. You can experience it,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Like it happens in physics, biology, chemistry, and so on. But politics, you cannot carry out any experiments, so can you?
No, sir, we cannot carry out, and we have to focus more on logic and reason.
So can you give an example of how the study of politics is also the study of science?
Sir, a very suitable example can be of electoral politics. And when we analyze the voters' preferences in accordance to region or ethnicity or caste or any other determinants, then we collect data, we observe the data, and through a very scientific approach, we are able to reach to a conclusion.
So that means we should be able to predict the result of any election. Am I right?
Sir, since it is human behavior, and it keeps on changing with time, Also, sir, the results depend upon the pool that is taken, and often the collection sample itself can be biased. For example, people often do not take women as 50% in their collection.
Okay. What is the science of elections called? Studying of elections?
Sir, I do not recollect the term right now.
But you are aware that there is a term which defines the science of elections. Am I right?
Yes, sir, but I cannot recollect it.
Okay, doesn't matter. Rajiv ji?
Thank you, sir. Har Har Mahadev Jaya?
Har Har Mahadev, sir.
And why did I wish you this way? Why did I greet you this way? Because?
Sir, because in Devghar there is a Shivling and a Shakti.
How many Shivlings? It's not a Shivling, it's in fact a Jyotirling.
Yes, sir, it's a Jyotirling and a Shakti.
Yeah, how many are there in the country?
Sir, there are 12.
Okay. Tell me, you put our agricultural reforms were discussed in a parliament of which nation?
So, are you asking that
the farmers' education? Yes, agriculture. It was discussed in a parliament of another country.
British. So it was discussed in British Parliament.
And what was our response to it? India's response?
So we said that it is an internal matter of India.
But how did we communicate to them? What is the mode of communication? You are a student of international relations. What is the form of communication of such expression of, you know, anger or what is it called?
So at that point of time, the spokesperson of Ministry of External Affairs had released a statement.
But the communication is not releasing of a statement. Communication is in a particular form.
So I cannot recollect.
Okay, doesn't matter. You put yoga, walking as in your, you know, ECA, that is the hobby. Are these hobbies or are they a part of life, a daily routine?
Sir, for me, it is both an interest and also a part of my daily routine.
Yes, but how does it qualify into a hobby? I mean, hobby is supposed to convey, at least to me, a different form of, rather than something that is already internalized in us. Like yoga and walking is a form that has been internalized in us. So it doesn't really appear to be a hobby. You can't be discussing with people that this is my hobby. Do you do so?
No, sir. But in the DAF, it was written that what are your hobbies or interest?
Yeah.
So if it had been written only hobby, I would not
then
have.
Would have then what would you have written?
So for me, sir, fitness activities have always interested me. But I'm not sure if I can call it a hobby or not.
Okay. Tell me, Jaya, what is the relationship between the RBI and the government treasury?
Sorry, sir,
A relationship between the Reserve Bank of India and the government treasury. How do they interact? What is the manner and topics on subjects on which they interact?
Sorry, sir, I don't know the answer.
Okay. How many forms of democracy can you mention?
Sir, I can say that first of all, there is a democracy like in India where there is a republic, where there is an elected head of the state. And in UK, there is a form of constitutional monarchy where there is democracy, but there is a hereditary head of the state. And also, sir, we can classify it in terms of liberal and illiberal democracies. And however, sir, I feel it is a very subjective term.
Okay. You are a student of history. Can you mention two game changers in the world history?
So, first of all, it was the Renaissance movement in Europe. And secondly, sir, I would, sir, second can be, sir, the colonization that took place.
In what manner did the Renaissance change the course of world history?
Sir, it brought man out from the dark ages to the age of enlightenment. Earlier, there were multiple authorities. There was the rule of church, there was the rule of the king. But after Renaissance, focus was on the reason of man. And since man has reason, it was postulated that man should be able to govern himself. And slowly, the focus was given on nation states and democratic rule and on liberty, equality, fraternity. Hence, the modernization approach.
Yeah. What are the determinants of a foreign policy? Just briefly, bullet forms.
So, geography, the cultural composition of a place, then sir, leadership, then sir, the history of a place can be a determinant.
Okay.
Then sir, its technological and economic capabilities.
Okay. And now my next question is on Indian history. Can you trace the history of India, both from archaeological and other perspectives, literary sources, foreign travelers, just a map sort of, if you were to introduce Indian history to an outsider or to a non-history student, how would you describe India's history so that it arouses my interest and keeps me, you know, glued to the Indian history?
Sir, Indian history has been an ever-evolving dimension. And as it has been said that multiple groups of people started coming to India and started adopting India as their own home. And if Indian history can be described in one sentence, then we can just say this. However, sir, in a more descriptive manner, Indian history started from the Paleolithic and the Neolithic ages. And since that point of time, there was beautiful cave paintings and megaliths, which are still being used in places like Jharkhand. And sir, after that, there was the Indus Valley civilization. And this led to the Vedic age and the Mahajanapadas. And the Mauryan Empire, sir, was the first Chakravarti Samrat of India, of Indian history. After that, sir, there were Guptas and sir, then there was the Mughal rulers and the, sir, then there was the Sultanates and then the Mughal rulers came. And these transformations led to finally a very cosmopolitan culture of India, where there were both Hindus and Muslims who live in unison. Also, sir, the trading areas like the Western Coast, they also had a substantial population of Jews, Parsis, and other communities. When the British came, they focused more on economic exploitation of India. However, Indians as a group were able to stand up against them. And ultimately, after more than 200 years, India achieved its independence and it became in a form that we can see it today. That is both a civilization state and also a state that is slowly transforming itself into a nation state.
Very good. History itself, during the freedom movement, it was said that Mahatma Gandhi's, you know, strategy to win independence or to gain independence for our country was the reason we got it so late. Had we adopted other measures, we could have perhaps got it much earlier. What is your assessment of the methodology, strategy, vision of Mahatma Gandhi ji to have brought independence in the form that it did?
So Mahatma Gandhi focused not only on end, but also on the right means to achieve that end. And therefore, we can say that maybe India would have achieved its independence before, but that is more of a retrospective analysis. And the form of independence that we got right now, when Mahatma Gandhi was the leader, it was a form of independence that involved even the weakest sections of the Indian society. And there lies the beauty of Indian freedom struggle. So, sir, I feel that if Mahatma Gandhi was not there, we would have missed so much on the national freedom struggle.
Okay, for instance, but have we failed his dreams? Has India failed his dreams?
Sir, India has progressed so much and Mahatma Gandhi would have been happy to some extent. However, in cases like communal violence, mob lynching, and the poor status of women, tribals, and the lower castes are still there, then I feel Mahatma Gandhi would have been really sad.
Okay, my another question is on foreign policy.
Yes.
What are the determinants of a successful foreign policy?
Sir, a successful foreign policy must focus only and only on national interest. However, it also needs to involve other dimensions that will help it promote its national interest. For example, its cultural composition, its soft power, its focus on geoeconomics, and also values like democracy and freedom, which helps to ensure that the country remains a very attractive destination and also that it is respected by its fellow nations.
What was the diarchy to direct control?
Sorry, sir?
Diarchy to direct control under the British.
Sir, it was started by Robert Clive and it focused on a dual rule where the civil laws would be looked after by the British and the criminal laws would be looked after by the Indians. And it was the Nizami Adalat and the Diwanat Adalat.
My last question to you. What were the factors that led to the disintegration of USSR, of Russia?
Sir, I personally feel that the reason for disintegration was that it focused on economic reforms. It did not focus on economic reforms, but it first focused on political reforms, unlike China. And so other factors were also there, like the very deep entrenched Cold War rivalry, which ensured that USSR focuses more on defense and lesser on the human resource of that area, and its weakened economy in 1990s, and the outreach of NATO very close to USSR.
Okay, while waiting for the chairman, sir, to come and join us, let me put one more question to you. What was the form of drain of wealth? Sir, you are there, sir. I already...
Oh, I was here throughout.
Okay. Sir, Jaya, my last question to you. What was the form of drain of wealth by the British? How did they exploit the resources of the country?
Sir, British forces were stationed in Britain, in India. And various British people were also living in India and remitting all the money earned in Britain. Also, sir, there were railways established and factories established by the British. However, all the profits of railways and the industries established by the British went to Britain. So, sir, this was the form of drain of wealth.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Just last few questions before we give you our feedback. You come from an area where nearby regions, they are infested with the Naxalite problems, so on. Suppose you are posted there as a district collector, what measures you would be taking in order to solve this problem or at least keep it under control?
Sir, my approach would be based on the extent of the problem in the area. If there is a high problem, then we have to focus more on a hard approach and involve the central intelligence agencies as well as the local police forces. However, right now, the problem of Naxalism is on the wane, and we can focus more on a soft approach, that is building infrastructure in the area, ensuring that the children of the area receive proper nutrition, proper food, the youth get proper skilling, so that they are not attracted towards Naxalism, and also that we are able to ensure that the Naxals are not able to utilize these people as a source of intelligence. And sir, I feel that ideally both the approaches should be mixed and matched.
Do you think that the main reason for the rise in Naxalism there was it a lack of employment opportunities, or was a lack of integration with the rest of the other areas, or economic disparities, or political exploitation? What could have been the reason?
Sir, the most important reason, in my opinion, was that since centuries, these areas have been excluded from the rest of India through geographical hindrances, and there has been low connectivity. Sir, the second reason is also that there has been endemic exploitation of tribals also, both by the outsiders who live in India as well as by the British and other foreign forces. So there is also an atmosphere of distrust among the people.
Okay. Now, you have given your choice as IAS number one.
Yes.
There, what is your first preference in terms of the state, and second and third?
Sir, my first preference is Jharkhand. Second is Madhya Pradesh. Third is Rajasthan.
All right. Why have you given these preferences? So, Jharkhand, I can understand, it's your home state.
Yes.
What about others?
Sir, I feel that the others are very similar to Jharkhand. Like, for example, in Madhya Pradesh, we have densely forested regions, and we have a highest population of tribals. And sir, in the case of Rajasthan, the problems that Jharkhand face and Rajasthan face are very much similar. Like in the case of child marriage and poor status of women. And also, sir, the issue of lack of connectivity of distant areas, etc. So I feel, sir, I can ensure that these areas can get the experience of the challenges that I have faced since childhood.
You mentioned about self-help groups for the women.
Yes.
Now, these days, it is the IT platform for the young educated women, which can provide them employment sitting at home, provided there is Wi-Fi connectivity and so on. So why not self-help groups based on the IT platform in digitization and in software or things of this kind, which could have marketing linkages with IT firms?
Sir, this is a very good idea and this can be adopted. However, sir, the challenge right now is that a majority of women are not very conversant with digital technology, and they have not even been educated properly. So I feel, sir, these ideas can be utilized in village areas in around 10 to 15 years from now, or even before, if we provide children with good quality education.
Okay. Do you wish to ask us any questions before we give you the feedback?
No, sir.
Before I give you the feedback, Neeraj-ji and Rajiv-ji, would you like to give her any suggestions or feedback? I'll come back in the end.
Jaya, all that I have to say is that since political science and international relations was your optional subject, you need to be very thorough on and you yourself said you follow Afghanistan, so I expected that you knew a little more about Afghanistan, a little more in depth. So try, and especially you are a student of JNU, So try to go beyond the headlines.
Yes.
And a little more about the origin of the Taliban and where it stands today. Many people confuse it with the Mujahideen that was set up to fight the Russians. But they are not the Mujahideens. In fact, there are people who were displaced by the Mujahideen and who were taken to Pakistan and kept in the camps there. And then they were trained to be guerrillas and pushed back. And because they were brought up in madrasas in Pakistan, they are called Talibs. Talib means students.
Yes, sir.
So you should know a little more rather than anybody who reads the newspapers. You need to have a little more insight and so on, okay?
Yes.
And that goes for other events also. Remember, as is often said, no one is looking for information. People are looking for analysis. Analysis of information is what a candidate is expected to display during UPSC interviews. So you should show your powers of analysis while answering questions. Your answers on political science were quite satisfactory. Otherwise, you are fine. Your articulation is fine. You are confident. You are self-assured. So there's no difficulty. All you need to do is that you need to go a little more in depth in your subjects, right?
Yes, sir.
Rajiv ji?
Thank you, sir. Jaya, just a very brief assessment. See, on the forms of democracy, see, our intent is to, as sir said, to find out your communication skills as to how you describe a situation. Knowledge is already been, that part is over. So on that, instead of giving a, you sort of described, you gave examples rather than I expected you to be more very specific on participative, deliberative democracy. That sort of, I mean, just giving one or two, because from a political science student, we would have expected, the board would expect to get specific answers to them rather than situations. One. Number two, on determinants of a foreign policy, I noticed that you started off and then you halted and then you again took off. So maybe by way of a suggestion, what you could do was that before you start to respond, you think over as to what points you are going to marshal in support of your argument or your response, rather than halting in between. That gives an impression that you are now fumbling for words or you are not very certain of what you are going to say. Third, Constitution, Mahatma Gandhi, I asked, you could have briefly described in a more, manner that the Constitution almost defines his dreams. So the shape that it took, the Constitution took, and the various aspects of it, see, for instance, secularism, all this that we have, so it is his dreams that have come true. So Gandhiji almost described what he did during the freedom struggle is almost a continuity of it is, and that is what we are doing today. And in the grassroots democracy, the directive principles of state policy, what are they are all dreams of Gandhiji. Then my last observation on the Indian response to the UK Parliament debating on the agricultural reforms, on the farmers' education, was that it is called the DEMERCHE, DEMERCHE. And that is the form of communication when a country, or at least India, when it wishes to make a lodge of protest with another country for something that they did not expect a friendly country to do. That is the form of communication. So the spokesperson, you rightly said, when he called Mr. Alex Alvis, the British High Commissioner to India, to lodge that protest. So as an international relations student also, you should know these terms that will, it almost defines what you are going to say instead of describing it in so many words. But all the best, Jaya. You did very well. Otherwise,
one small point, sir. Rajiv ji,
sir?
I'm sorry to just make a small correction. It is pronounced as DEMERCHE.
Oh, sir, I was not sure of the pronunciation. That's why I spelled out the word to her, sir.
DEMERCHE.
Okay.
All right, Jaya. Pleasure meeting you. May I first ask you, in the other mock interview that you have attended, have you been given any tips what to do?
So I have been told to be more confident in my previous interview. And also, sir, I could not answer a few questions of history at that point of time. And so they have told me to look into the history part.
Yes. So that, of course, is one which is general, which should be there for all the candidates. Be more confident, be more knowledgeable as much as you can. In addition, I would say be assured. You should not be conscious. If you don't know any question, don't be conscious about it. Just say, sorry, sir, I don't know, or sir or madam. One thing which I noticed in your case, that's why I asked you this question, that you don't prolong your answer beyond a point. You stop it when you feel that you have answered the question. So this is a good quality. Also, this needs to be tempered with, in the sense that when you are answering a question, prepare the structure of the answer in your mind and give the answer to the panel. Sometimes you stop the answer at a point where, I mean, it's right, it's a very good quality, where possibly a word or two could have been added. So just make sure that your answer is complete when you are answering a question. Having said this, I would also like to say that your background would make it prone to a number of questions which you have been told by Mr. Neeraj Kumar and Rajiv Ji about international situation, about Naxalism, about tribal areas, about Taliban, which is going to be a major problem going forward. And right now, everybody is talking to Taliban. And there is, of course, another thing. U.S. is again resumed some bombing and so on and so forth. So this problem is going to further go up, conflagrate. You should be prepared. Then Parliament would be in session. There would be a number of issues which would come up. Pegasus thing, farmers' agitation and so on. You should be adequately prepared. During the Independence Day, this thing is after Independence or before Independence? Which day?
After Independence Day, on 7th September.
7th September. So you should also see, it is possible that there may be a few new schemes which could be announced by the government around the Independence Day. There could also be a few announcements pertaining to the farmers' agitation. Now, farmers' agitation could be another area where you could be asked questions, and you should go into the genesis of the problem and what you feel. There was some discussion today, but still, what is your view? And that should be very intelligently structured in your mind. You can do a bit of reading on this further. It is becoming more of a political issue than an economic issue because it is under stay. The Supreme Court has stayed. The government has also said that nothing would happen and so on, but it's still going on. So we have to be prepared for all kinds of questions. When you go there, you know your dress code should be proper, formal, and wear a smile, which you always do, but it should be a gentle, continuous smile. So altogether, you are set to go. Very well prepared. You are a good personality. Wish you all good luck. Hope you make it.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
All the best, Jaya.
All the best. God bless you.
Thank you. Jalanu bhaiya, iske baad.